R. The French horn. Few would question how deeply its sound affects human feeling and thought. In 1858, Hector Berlioz defined the horn's sound as noble and melancholic. What is it that makes the French horn sound both heroic and nostalgic? And how does this relate to Star Trek?
Hello again, I'm Dave Page, and this is Scoring Star Trek. Recently, I went back to my high school yearbooks and found a couple of photos of me in the Central High School Bobcat Band from the mid-70s. My instrument? The French horn. Well, I haven't touched one since graduation, and then I sold my Con 6D so I could buy a Fender Twin Reverb amp. A subscriber recently commented on his good fortune of having had Alexander Courage as an instructor during his graduate studies at USC. He said, "I can still hear his voice. The French horns are like a glue, you see," stretching his hands apart like they were dipped in honey to emphasize the point. Well, another viewer commented, "I hope you'll devote an episode to the life of a studio orchestra musician at the time of the original series." Well, in this video, I will attempt to establish a link from the golden years of the Hollywood studio system, you know, 1930s through 1950s, through the freelance era of the 60s and 70s, and the one Star Trek veteran session horn player who stands out as a common thread, culminating in this iconic scene from, yes, Star Wars. I'm sure you know who wrote that. In the program notes for the premiere of John Williams' Concerto for Horn and Orchestra, he wrote, "When I've tried to analyze my lifelong love of the French horn, I've had to conclude that it's mainly because of the horn's capacity to stir memories of antiquity. The very sound of the French horn conjures images stored in the collective psyche. It's an instrument that invites us to dream backward to the ancient time." Well, this well-known scene, Binary Sunset, is the first time in the entire Star Wars franchise we hear the Force leitmotif, according to Dr. Erica Wilson, a professional horn player and instructor in San Francisco. But why the solo French horn for this thematic debut? Dr. Wilson notes, "First, the horn sound supports the leitmotif's representation of the narrative's heroes, given the horn's associations with strength, honor, heroism, and noble purpose. These are intrinsic, culturally embedded associations referenced by the horn sound. Second, the horn also communicates complex emotions other than the ones represented by the leitmotif. The horn is not only a conveyor of heroism and noble purpose, but also evokes yearning, love, sadness, loss, pain, and nostalgia." Of course, John Williams knew this, and he knew just how to write for the horn. It might seem silly for me to say that the great John Williams learned this skill from his experiences with a single horn player, so I won't. But I'll let him say it for himself. Quote, "He was the premier first horn player on virtually every recording to come out of Hollywood for over 40 years. and I can honestly say that what I know about writing for the French horn, I learned from him." Unquote. I will name this person in a bit, but first a brief history. Well, let's go back in time, about 100 years. What would that be? 1923. And enter a fine movie theater in any large city. We'll probably see either a pit orchestra or a theater organ, sometimes both. In this same year, 1923, Great Britain's most dominant French hornist, Alfred Brain, uncle to the well-known Dennis Brain, arrived to play principal horn for the LA Philharmonic. He was a cultured gentleman, a fine chef and host who would go on to teach and mentor a generation of horn players. Well, this was the Roaring Twenties. Back then, an evening at the movies was a big deal. There would first be an overture, followed by a stage show with vaudeville music and dancing girls. And then a first-run silent movie, accompanied by the organ or the orchestra. Well, this employed lots of musicians across the country, but sadly, it would not outlast the advent of the talkie in 1927. In a few years, the pit orchestras vanished, thousands of musicians were out of work, and just as the Great Depression was taking hold.
Hey, don't you remember? I'm your pal. Brother, can you spare a dime?
Well, suddenly a new industry was born. The film studios figured out that recording music and then mating it to film was a very economical way to work. You could hire great musicians to record one great performance that would be heard time and time again for the life of the film. I mean, it sounds funny to say that now, but it was utterly groundbreaking back then. So all the studios went fully into music production, hiring composers and orchestrators and musicians on a contract basis. Among them, Alf Brain, who I mentioned a moment ago, went to work for MGM Studios and then later for Fox. Well, FDR's New Deal, the massive federal program to get Americans working again, included the Federal Music Project, which established the Works Progress Administration, or WPA, orchestras in an effort to lower unemployment among musicians and provide low-cost or free entertainment to the public. In Howard Hilliard's 1998 doctoral dissertation, which is my source for a lot of this material, I learned that a very talented young horn player, a teenager, managed to get into a WPA symphony after the death of his father, a clarinetist, and he became the breadwinner for his mother and four siblings. But his presence began to get attention, and it wasn't too long before Alf Brain recruited young Vince DeRosa for 20th Century Fox. DeRosa served during World War II in the California Army Air Force's radio production unit, but after his service, he started a career unlike any before and since. According to Hilliard, DeRosa had a near monopoly as the first call studio hornist from 1958 through the 1980s. His film and TV credits are vast and include Henry Mancini's score for The Days of Wine and Roses, that opening French horn solo was inspired by and composed for Vince DeRosa. It was DeRosa that John Williams had credited with teaching him everything he knew about writing for the horn. He was the connective tissue, so to speak, spanning the Hollywood studio contract era, the post-contract freelance era, including his work on Star Trek, and inspiring other players and composers like John Williams. Well, of course, DeRosa wasn't the only hornist in L.A. at the time. James Decker, no relation to... was another protege of Alf Brain and was also at the top of the fraternity. After the studio contracts ended, he was approached by Paramount to be, quote, first call for them. No contract, but they would pay double if he agreed. He said, even the TV shows like The Odd Couple, Mission Impossible, and Star Trek were under that obligation. By my count, Decker was listed on no less than 21 sessions through all three seasons of Star Trek, whereas Vince DeRosa played on just four, only because he was in such demand. Okay, well, the music of focus here is again George Duning and his outstanding partial score for episode 51, Return to Tomorrow. His orchestra includes 8 violins, 4 violas, 3 cellos, a single bass, that's a 16-piece string section. Aside from the harp, percussion, and organ, there are 4 French horns, no woodwinds or other brass. And look at this, Decker and DeRosa together with Bill Henshaw and Richard Parisi. Just over 18 minutes of music were recorded for the episode, the rest being tracked cues from prior episode, including Duning's previous Metamorphosis,
but it is full of unknowns, and we can't risk both of us being off the ship. How far gone, sir? On the other hand,
and Gerald Fried's Amok Time.
It is I.
To bring. Parted
from. What were you saying?
And interestingly, Fred Steiner's Romulan Black Ship theme is adapted here by George Duning for the villainous Hinnok while occupying Spock's body.
This woman will assist me. Take me to your pharmacology laboratory.
Bones. What?
Well, let's look at a couple of Duning's cues from Return to Tomorrow. If you recall from the previous video on Metamorphosis, I pointed out Duning's tendency to employ an ascending construct to start his melodies, often larger intervals. Duning composed a wonderful leitmotif for Thalesa, the beloved of Sargon. The initial usage is early on when we first meet Dr. Anne Mulhall in the transporter room.
They or it.
Who are you?
Dr. Anne Mulhall, astrobiologist.
And again, when the entity Sargon has first occupied Kirk's body and is explaining to Spock and McCoy what happened to their world, he stops fondly at one of the still-lighted spheres in which the essence of Thalesa resides.
And Thalesa. Thalesa, my Thalesa. I am pleased you survived.
All right, later in the sick bay, the first trial transference of all three takes place. Amid the risks, it is a beautiful and poignant moment when Sargon and Thalesa are able to see each other and be physically together after 500,000 years apart. Here's the cue transcription. Thalesa recalls.
Thank you.
Well, probably the most recognized and loved cue from Return to Tomorrow is the so-called Risk is Our Business scene. Dunning composed the cue, Kirk's philosophy for this stirring monologue, played brilliantly by Shatner. And it's a marvelous adaptation of the Courage Enterprise fanfare. But the scene doesn't start with it. As Kirk begins, a tracked cue from Metamorphosis is heard first. It's from an equally stirring Kirk moment as he's trying to sway Cochrane to help them get away from the Companion. Remember this?
What's it like out there in the galaxy?
We're on 1,000 planets and spreading out. We cross fantastic distances, and everything's alive, Cochrane. Life everywhere, we estimate. There are millions of planets with intelligent life. We haven't begun to map them. Interesting.
Well, the Desilu music editors just nailed this one. I never realized it until working on this video. The two cues are so compatible, same composer, essentially the same orchestration, that it seems it's one long cue with a key change. But it's not. So here is a score transcription for combined cues, You've Got It, and Kirk's Philosophy.
I'm in command. I could order this. But I'm not.
But before I close, it is worth sharing something else I found in Dr. Hilliard's dissertation on the horn players in L.A. back in the day. In 1951, the Los Angeles Horn Club was established to encourage a spirit of community and support, a place to practice and hone playing skills, and just to have fun. Its founding member? It was Alfred Brain. By then, he was the elder statesman of the group, and he fostered a spirit of camaraderie, not competition. He always encouraged those around him and protected the position of those less talented. He was looked upon as a father figure and loved as a human being. Under his leadership could flourish some of the greatest horn players of all time. Vince DeRosa, Jim Decker, Sinclair Lott, Jack Cave, Gail Robinson, Richard Parisi, to mention a few. All of these brought their talents to the scoring stages of Star Trek, where its music will live long and prosper. I'll see you next time. This well-known scene in Binary Sunset is the first time in the entire Star Wars franchise we hear the Force. Whoops! Still going right now. Well, that's a lot of information for one video. So Oh, gosh. That's all backwards. And interestingly, Fred Steiner's Romulan Black Sheep theme. Black Sheep. Black Sheep